Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Cristiano Tommassoni. I'm from the University of Perugia, Italy. The small presentation you are watching is only a small sample of what you will see in my distinguished microwave lecture. My distinguished microwave lecture is on additive manufacturing and it is entitled Additive Manufacturing: Emerging Opportunities for Microwave Components. In my DML presentation, I will present different additive manufacturing technologies and I will show how we can exploit them for the manufacturing of microwave components. Well, let's start with the stereolithography technology. In this case, we have a vat of liquid polymer resin, which is cured and hardened layer by using ultraviolet light. Well, this technology is quite versatile, as well as many other additive manufacturing technology, by the way. Indeed, we have the possibility of new classes of components with non-conventional geometries. Geometries which can be difficult to manufacture by using traditional manufacturing technologies like milling techniques, for example. It has also an high accuracy. Indeed, its resolution ranges from 25 to 50 microns, so this is quite good. The low cost of resins, as well as the low cost of the printing machinery, make this technology very popular. In addition, it is also easy to use because you have just to buy a 3D printing machinery and plug and play. It allows fast prototyping. Unfortunately, the manufactured objects are in plastic, so they have not the high resistance and they are susceptible to deformation under high temperature. In any case, some action can be taken in order to mitigate such problems. And now some consideration. Our object is manufactured layer by layer from top to bottom, as you can see here. The manufacturing tilt of the object must be carefully considered because it impacts on the number of supporting structures. Supporting structures are needed for the not self-supporting part of our object. I can show you what I mean. This is a supporting structure that will be removed, but we use it to stick this layer. Indeed, when we start this layer, we have to manufacture this part and we need something to stick it. It is not always necessary. For example, for this layer, we don't need an additional supporting structure because in this case, the layer is stick directly to our object. I want also to point out the importance of additive manufacturing oriented design because there are several things to take into account, as we will see in the extended DML talk. And it is also important that post-processing, in which we have to wash the object by using alcohol to remove the not solidified polymer using this, and then supporting structure must be removed, of course. And finally, materials we manufacture have high dielectric losses and are in general unsuitable for use as a dielectric materials, unless you don't need dissipation, for example, as in the case of an attenuator. But in general, we use it to mimic a metal in the sense that we manufacture an object and then we have to metallize it. This is an example of filter manufactured by using this technology. We will see it better during my extended DML talk, but what I want to point out here is that thanks to the non-conventional geometry, we obtain a very small filter with transmission zeros. Okay, transmission zeros are allowed here thanks to this complex network of wires that we was able to reproduce directly by using this technology. This part should be metallized and we use in this case the electroplating. This is instead a magic T. In this case, thanks to the non-conventional geometry, the magic T has branches that are all in the E-plane. And additionally, you can see some slots here. This depends on the fact that in this case also electroless plating has been used. And now let's consider another very interesting 3D printing technology, the laser melting sintering. In this case, we have a powder bed and a laser to melt infused material powder together. The object is also in this case manufactured layer by layer, of course. It is versatile, this method, in the sense that it allows non-conventional geometries, but the main advantage is that we obtain objects directly in metal, so we have high mechanical performances. And also, monolithic manufacturing is allowed. Indeed, there is no longer need to manufacture the object in two halves as in the stereolithography. That's why there is no need to spray the metal paint in the internal part to make it conductive or to make slots in the structure in order to allow the electroless plating. So this is an advantage. And then we have also high accuracy. Indeed, the resolution ranges from 25 to 100 microns, and the cost is relatively high, unfortunately, because of the cost of the 3D printing technology and also because it is not plug and play, and several parameters must be set in the machinery. So if you want good results, you need expert guys to make the printing process. Also, with this technology, we need another manufacturing-oriented design in order to obtain performant results. In general, we start with an initial electromagnetic design, and then we pass to the additive manufacturing-oriented design. In this case, for example, we chamfered the two irises on the top, and we transform the rectangular iris into an ellipsoidal one. This allowed us to avoid internal supporting structures. And then we passed it to the mechanical design, in which added two pedestals in order to make stable the object during the manufacturing, and we also added the flanges. This is the orientation we select with no tilt angle, and this is the fabrication. Of course, there are a lot of things to say about it, but there is no time, and we will see it better in the extended talk. But what I want to point out is that the Q factor here is up to 7,000, and this is very high, especially considering that we have not silver plated the filter. If we silver plated it, we can obtain much better results. Here you can see the comparison between measurements and simulation for the filter we have seen in the previous slide. As you can see, the results are very good except for a small frequency shift of 45 MHz that can be recovered in any case. Okay, and this is also the way in which we can estimate the surface resistivity of the manufactured object. Indeed, we can compare the measurement with the simulation of the filter obtained by using different resistivities. As you can see here, we have two prototypes, but one of the two seems to reach about 12 microohm per centimeter as a resistivity. This is another very interesting 3D printing technology. It is called lithography-based ceramic manufacturing. It consists of alumina suspended in a photoreactive organic binder. They call it slurry. Then the slurry is hardened layer by layer by using light to obtain the so-called green body. Then the green body needs thermal post-processing up to 600 degrees. During this process, there is a shrinkage of the object of about 20%, and this must be, of course, taken into account. But in any case, this is a versatile process, a versatile technology, because it allows non-conventional geometries. But what is most interesting is that the material produced with this technology has very low losses. The loss tangent of this ceramic material is 8 multiplied by 10 up to minus 5. So this material can be used as a dielectric material in our components because the losses are very low. Unfortunately, this technology is relatively high cost and it is not plug and play. Indeed, during the design of the object you can see in the photos, we interact with the lithos, with the manufacturer, because they gave us some interesting advice in order to make the object easy to manufacture. Considering the remarkable performance of this material, An excellent test for this technology is, of course, a dielectric filter. Detail of this will be done in the extended DML talk. But what I want to point out is that thanks to the shaped ceramics that it is possible because this is a 3D printing technology, we obtain a very wide band, and this is not common for dielectric filters. Then we also obtain the miniaturization thanks to the dielectric constant of 9.5, and we obtain also a low loss filter thanks to the loss tangent that is very low. In my DML presentation, I will also stress out how important is an additive manufacturing-oriented design, especially for the 3D printing in ceramics. Indeed, in this case, we have not only the problems related to the manufacturing phase, but also to the post-processing phase. Especially, we have to deal with the deformation during the shrinkage. Here, for example, we can see a couple of structures in which a wrong design leads to a deformed and warped structure. Here, what happened instead after an additive manufacturing-oriented design in which we have no deformations. Very well, ladies and gentlemen, this concludes my short presentation. I hope to meet you at my DML presentation, where I will present more results, more examples, and more techniques about the exciting world of 3D printing technologies. Thank you. Thank you very much for your attention.